Thank you, everyone. My name is Anagha. I'm currently pursuing my master's in clinical psychology from Christ Redeemed University. Thank you for giving me such an opportunity to present this paper. So what I'm trying to propose here is a theoretical model which says that authoritarian parenting style leads to anxiety among young adults. So according to Diana Bomrand, parenting styles are of three types: authoritarian, authoritative, and permissive. She divided them based on two dimensions, demandingness and responsiveness. Demandingness refers to the standards and demands set by parents, example, control, supervision, and the extent parents control their children's behavior or demand maturity. Responsiveness, on the other hand, reflect parents' responses to or communication with their children. It is the degree to which parents are accepting and sensitive to their children's emotional and developmental needs. So the first type of parenting, authoritative, is characterized by high demandingness and high responsiveness. Authoritative parenting is also known as democratic parenting. So they have high expectations for the achievement from the children, but they also are very warm and responsive. They set rules and enforce boundaries by having open discussions, providing guidance, and using reasoning. These parents provide their kids with reasoning and explanation for their action. Explanations allow children to have a sense of awareness and teach kids about values, goals, and morals. So their kind of parenting is more affectionate and supportive. They provide their children with autonomy and encourage independence. On the other hand, authoritarian parenting characterizes high demandingness and low responsiveness. They demand high standards, and authoritarian parents demand blind obedience using reasons such as, you have to do this because I said so. So they only allow one-way communication through rules and orders. Any attempts to reason with them are seen as backtalk. They are very unresponsive to their children's needs and are generally not nurturing. Coming to permissive parenting, they have permissive parenting characterizes low demandingness and high responsiveness. They set very few rules and boundaries, but are very warm and indulgent. So coming to the second variable, perfectionism. Perfectionism has been associated with positive attributes such as conscientiousness, achievement, striving, order, self-discipline, organization, etc. But perfectionism also seems related to various kind of disorders such as depression, anxiety, OCD, suicidality, etc. So perfectionism can be defined as a rigid adherence to unrealistically high personal standards, hypersensitivity to mistakes. So Hollander in 1965 proposed that perfectionism involves demanding from oneself a much higher quality of work than is necessary and feeling as though less than perfect performance is unacceptable. A large number of recent empirical investigations on of perfectionism also support the idea that perfectionism has adaptive and maladaptive components. This was supported by the social expectation model, which suggests that perfectionism develops when children learn they must meet achievements and or behavioral expectations held by their parents to earn their parents' love and approval. So this is also in line with the Rogers' work on contingent self-worth, which suggested that so low self-esteem may be associated with children's beliefs that parental approval is contingent on meeting their expectations. Coming to the third variable, which is defensive pessimism. Defensive pessimism is a cognitive strategy, which is mainly characterized of defensive expectations and reflectivity. Defensive expectations refers to setting unrealistically low expectations prior to an evaluative event, and reflectivity refers to thinking through multiple possible outcomes to an evaluative event. Defensive pessimism as a cognitive strategy involves setting unrealistically low expectations and thinking through worst case outcomes of an upcoming situation, even though success has been experienced in the past. And the fourth variable, anxiety. We all experience anxiety, and it is natural. It is a natural human state, as we all know. Anxiety helps us to identify and respond to danger during flight and fight situations. It can also motivate us to face up to dealing with difficult challenges. But the right amount of anxiety can help us perform better and stimulate action and creativity. But there's another side to anxiety. Persistent anxiety causes real emotional distress and can lead to us becoming unwell, and at worst, to developing anxiety disorders such as phobias, panic attacks, OCDs, etc. Anxieties at this level can have a truly distressing and debilitating impact on our lives and impact on our physical as well as our mental health. Moving to the next slide. So the rationale of my study is that the model says high parental control, which is a part of authoritarian parenting, high parental control and criticism over their children is a main, like I said, is a main characteristic of authoritarian parenting, which will in turn make children to develop perfectionistic tendencies. So due to high demandingness and criticism, children become scared of failure and work till perfection to achieve the standard. The setting of high standard leads to the development of use of cognitive strategies such as defensive pessimism to manage the anxiety that occurred due to the fear of failure or inability to achieve the standard held. Hence, it is proposed that the self-protection strategy, which is defensive pessimism, itself buffers or harnesses anxiety. So when they set low expectation levels and think of all possible negative outcomes, a higher amount of effort is put on to overcome the situation, and this will again harness anxiety. Moving to the next slide, the hypothesis, there are three hypotheses proposed here. Hypothesis number one, there will be a significant positive relationship between authoritarian parenting style and perfectionism. Second hypothesis is perfectionism will predict defensive pessimism. And third one is young adults who are defensive pessimists will be more likely to develop anxiety. So this is the model that I'm presenting, where it shows that authoritarian parenting leads to perfectionism, which will make the young adults to develop a cognitive strategy called defensive pessimism, and use of defensive pessimism in turn buffers anxiety. So what makes my research different from the previous defensive pessimist researchers is that it is usually researched or said that defensive pessimism is a cognitive strategy used to reduce the anxiety faced by people. But in turn, what I'm proposing here is usage of defensive pessimism itself creates anxiety, and we will be in a vicious cycle. So here, in order to understand this relationship, I have analyzed 10 research papers which were based on thematic basis on the relationship between each of these variables. So next slide, coming to the analysis, the most prominent study in the field of parenting style and perfectionism was done by Hirabayashi in the year 2005. In his study titled The Role of Parental Style on Self-Handicapping and Defensive Pessimism in Asian American College Students, it was found that authoritarian parenting was significantly related to perfectionism among college students. The pressures that Asian American college students feel may be particularly harmful, as results from the quantitative analysis showed that perceived authoritarian parental style was related to higher levels of perfectionism. This perfectionism is then strongly related to the use of defensive academic strategies. In Miller, Lambert, and Omister's study named Parenting Style, Perfectionism, and Creativity in High Ability and High Achieving Young Adult, they conducted a path analysis model to understand the relationship between different parenting style and creativity among young adults. It was found that perceived authoritarian parenting style appears to have detrimental consequences in various areas for high ability and high achieving young adults, related to increases in socially prescribed perfectionism and decreases in creativity. Akiko Watabe conducted a study to examine the relationship between perfectionism, parenting style, along with GPA and socioeconomic status through a reward and punishment computer-based learning task among college students. So the results of the study indicated a positive relationship between maladaptive perfectionism and authoritarian parenting style. An authoritarian parenting style is often seen as being very harsh in most of the cultures, with high demands being placed on the child without much warmth and support being provided. Perhaps this parenting style might foster more maladaptive aspects of perfectionism. And the findings of the study provide some support for this insight. For example, the authoritarian parenting style was linked to parental expectations to be perfect, feelings of being criticized, doubts about abilities, and being more concerned about making mistakes. Another study conducted by David R. Hibbard and Gail E. Walton in 2014 tried to find the development of traits of perfectionist traits in children. The result indicated that parenting styles do play an important role in development of perfectionism. There was a significant relationship between authoritarian parenting style and socially prescribed perfectionism. Among both males and females who were the participants, the research showed that authoritarian style was related to parental expectations to be perfect, feelings of being criticized, and doubts about abilities. Moreover, this relationship was even more pronounced for males who tended to be more concerned about making mistakes when they perceived their mothers and fathers as parenting with characteristics of authoritarian style. So this finding suggests that a combination of parenting characteristic is not productive and will lead to development of maladaptive perfectionism. Another study conducted by Kawamura, Frost, and Hummets were also in similar lines with the study, which revealed that authoritarian parenting style is related to particularly negative aspects of perfectionism, such as excessive doubts, extreme concern for making mistakes among college student population. And the results of study conducted by Gong, Fletcher, and Bolin were in line with that of social reaction model, which was proposed by Flett. So it suggests that some children become perfectionists after consistent exposure to harsh environments. When parents fail to set standards for their children and do not provide appropriate feedback regarding their children's performance, children may establish their own unreasonably high standards. Children exposed to harsh living conditions and lack of feedback may become perfectionists as a way of self-protective reasons. It says that perfectionism may provide a sense of control for children and act as a coping mechanism. And they also use it to reduce exposure to shame and humiliation. For example, if I'm perfect, no one will hurt me. Coming to the second part of the model, the study conducted by, again, Hirabayashi also talks about relationship between perfectionism and cognitive strategies. Concerns over mistakes can be conceptualized as a measure of negative reaction to mistakes. The feeling that making mistake is same as failing and that failure will lead to loss of respect from others. In such situations, defensive pessimism can provide that protection from failure and loss of respect from others. If we look specifically, the study indicated that young adults who perceived their mothers as authoritarian parents indicated higher use of defensive pessimism and found to be perfectionistic tendencies. When the perfectionism trait variable was controlled in the study, these students used fewer cognitive strategies like defensive pessimism. This indicates that perfectionism is a much more salient variable in the use of defensive academic strategies. Also, the results from the interviews support the use of defensive pessimism as both a self-presentation and a self-protection strategies. So another study conducted by Sujitra Rui Chaudhary, she conducted a study to understand the relationship between defensive pessimism and perfectionism and found that both perfectionism and defensive pessimism seems to have common features of negative thinking, fear of failure, worry, negative anticipations, and a tendency to preserve self-worth, which explains the positive correlation between the two variables. Defensive pessimism is usually considered as a cognitive strategy that is used to reduce anxiety. But the question is it actually reducing the anxiety or increasing it? We can look at a few more studies conducted on this. One of the prominent researchers on this topic is Julie Norum, who is a psychology professor at Wellesley College and author of the famous book, The Positive Power of Negative Thinking. And I'm glad I got an opportunity to talk to her about this study as well. In her study of defensive pessimism, anxiety, and complexity of evaluative self-regulation, it was found that people who use defensive pessimism reliably report greater levels of trait anxiety and neuroticism and lower self-esteem. They often report more negative effect generally, and they have more negative expectations for their performance. They report more goal conflict, and they generate more negative potential outcomes and plans than those who use strategic optimism. In this study, results showed that even though defensive pessimism did...
sorry to interrupt you. You are exceeding your time. It's already 14 minutes. So kindly conclude your presentation.
Yes, yes. I'm so sorry. I'm almost towards the end. Okay. So in this study, results showed that even though defensive pessimists did well initially, gradually in the third year of their college, they did very poor compared to strategic optimists. Thus, when comparing strategic optimists to defensive pessimists, it is easy to find that defensive pessimists experience more negative emotion than strategic optimists. And another study conducted by Prasen also talks about a similar finding, which says that defensive pessimism was associated with negative mood. So the theoretical model that I'm presenting here is based on the analysis of a few research papers and will be tested later. And the, coming to the implications of the study, the findings of the study can be important as it can be used to develop various intervention strategies in the field of clinical psychology as well as positive psychology, defensive pessimism, or maybe in the field of and also in the field of parenting styles, mental health, I'm sorry for exceeding the time limit. I will wrap it up. So mental health is not just absence of disorders. So when we look at the history post-World War II, the field of psychology forgot one of the most important principles of discipline, which is the life above zero. The field of positive psychology looks at the challenges and difficulties faced by individuals on day-to-day life. Positive emotions like contentment, love, and joy can be broad people's thoughts and actions and improve the personal resources, social to psychological and physical to intellectual. Thus, it is necessary to look at the strengths of and weaknesses of person and manage it to the increase the quality and maintain a life above zero. And another implication is that it can also be used to throw light into the long run effect of authoritarian parenting style and give us path of how authoritarian parenting can lead to development of anxiety. That's all. Thank you so much.